It's the light that pierces through you to the darkest hidden place. It knows your deepest secrets, but it never looks away. It's the gentle hand.
Good morning.
Good morning.
We're going to start with our announcements first. We have so many things coming up. It's so exciting. And so if you turn to the back page of your bulletin, you can see that this week we've got Bible study, and we also have a leadership meeting, and that's at 7 o'clock. Both of those things are on Tuesday. Thursday, we've got Unwind. So much fun. Just bring a dish, bring a bag of chips or whatever, and come and enjoy the fellowship that we have for Unwind. On Saturday, August 27th, that's coming up real quick. That's that motorcycle for missions. So Paul's in charge of that, and we're going to, we still need some helpers, some volunteers. I'm sure we have them. We just don't have them down by name. So if you want to sign up to be in the bakes, like at the bake sale table or the registration table, Paul will have a new registration forms after church so you can sign up. And don't forget, we need to bake, so let's start baking and baking. And so that'll be lots of fun. That's coming up. Now then, upcoming in September on the 15th, we're going to have an Unwind soup off. So we're going to all bring in different kinds of soup, and we will have a contest to see who has the best. So if you really hate to make soup and you don't want to, you can always bring crackers or something to go along with it. But we want to see a lot of soups here. I was going to tell you that Penny and I bought the soup bowls when we were in Shipshewana. So we have lots of soup bowls and we're ready to go. So that'll be fun. And then I had the date wrong on the next thing. That is actually a Sunday, the 25th. And that is going to be a picnic with the Winnemac Church. We were kind of calling them the Trinimacs. We don't know if that'll catch on or not, but we're testing it out there in writing. It looks a little weird. So Trinity and Winnemac will get together in their city park at 12:30 on that Sunday, and we need to bring a covered dish. And they are going to supply everything else we need. And then the next year, if they still like us, we'll invite them to come over here, and we'll have one someplace over here. So that, oh, I don't know. You're right. All right, so this is a trial run. We better all be on our best behavior. Okay, so that's a lot of upcoming things. Does anybody else have any announcements? Woo. All right, then, let's stand up and sing. You guys been watching the stars and the moon this week? Beautiful moon. Driving home from Shipshewana, I about had to bring my visor down. It was so bright in my eyes.
Lord of all creation, of water, earth, and sky, the heavens are your tabernacle. Glory to the Lord on high, God of wonders beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy. Universe declares your majesty. You are holy.
Celebrate the light. When I stumble in the darkness, I will call your name by night. God of wonders.
United Methodist Church, where the Holy Spirit dwells. Aren't you glad? I can't tell you how many times through the week in different conversations with different people I have the opportunity to share what a sacred place we have here and how the Holy Spirit is so alive and working among us. I'm just so proud to be a part of this church family. Psalm 148, selected verses. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise Him from the skies. Praise Him, all His angels. Praise Him, all the armies of the earth. Praise Him, sun and moon. Praise Him, all you twinkling stars. Praise Him, skies above. Praise Him, vapors high above the clouds. Let every created thing give praise to the Lord. Praise the Lord. Our Father in heaven, we praise you. We glorify your name. We pray that you would hear the songs that we sing. We pray that the meditation of our hearts and minds would be pleasing to you in your sight. We pray that your Holy Spirit would move among us, healing, encouraging, and strengthening every one of us, including those present with our online family. Do a mighty work in this hour that we're together, we pray. Such a mighty work that we can't help but take it with us and share it with others. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen.
Special guest for this next song.
This is Olivia's, one of her favorite songs.
Favorite song.
Yes.
Girls up there.
And we might pick up you girls. Once you guys get the rhythm of the song, come join us. Group song. Let's stand up and sing. It's a 7-11 song. 11 words sang. Seven songs sang 11 times. Okay.
Put on the garment of praise. That's how we fight our battle.
This is how I fight my battles. 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 It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. This is how I fight my battles. Fight my battles. This is how I 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 fight my battles. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. This is how I fight my battles. 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 It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
You want to come up?
I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles.
This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles.
This is how I fight my battles.
This is how I fight my battles.
Wow, that was great. Thank you, guys. We fight our battles every day. There's always someone after us, and we have all these children to help us fight our battles, our future in Jesus. Okay, what do we got next? How about joys and concerns?
For all the prayers for my family, my mom's going through hospice. It's been a great God thing. And number two, Larry went out and picked sweet corn, so we've got a corn in the back, and everybody can take home some.
Okay. Tim, that mic is a little iffy. Is that the good one? Okay. Just sing, say loud, okay.
Let's keep the Hickory Creek in our prayers. They got COVID.
Oh, dear.
Phil Cohey told me Wednesday night at our meeting that he cannot go in and see Melinda because of the COVID.
That's so hard because they're so weak anyway. All right, Carolyn.
Yeah, I have a joy. I had to celebrate our 55th class reunion last night, so I'm a little tired.
Class reunions, you gotta love them, or not.
Okay, I have a couple joys and concerns, both. First of all, I think everybody has noticed we just love her to death, but Miss Judy Abt is here today. We're just so happy to have her here.
And missed you.
Another joy I have an update fresh off the press this morning about Drew Strasser. He is off the ventilator.
Okay.
Praise God. However, that is not an easy process. I'm going to try to get all of this exactly right. Because what that means is he's going through withdrawals. And it's very difficult, as everybody has heard, you know, what that is like. So the prayer from his mother is, please pray for Drew to feel better after being on all those narcotics. He's hot and going through withdrawals. He's breathing great, but he's ready to eat, drink, and feel better. He's very responsive and a little less confused. Now, last night was tough, but every moment, every hour gets a little better, a little clearer. He's asking a lot of questions, doesn't understand what has happened. The doctors still do not know why his heart stopped, so they're still working on that. So pray for his system to get it all out and to feel better soon. Grandma Jill texted me this morning and wanted me to let Trinity know how much it means to the family, all of her prayers. She it really just means the world. And she feels like it's made a difference. So she wanted to say thanks to Trinity.
Thank
you. Our family did come home this weekend, so we've had a great weekend. Again, safe travels for them to going back to Pennsylvania today. And 1 year ago today, we discovered my brother had died. And we did not know that for several days. So we don't count today as the day he died. It was the day he was found. So it's been a year. Everybody who's lost somebody knows how tough that is. We need to pray this for the Scott Davis family, because we know that happened at the same time. We know what happened this coming week. And for Diana Gilland, because Mike was at the same time. So just remember to love everybody.
I have an update on Becky. It was the one that emailed me. She said she's feeling a lot better. They have her off of all of the antibiotics. And so now they're just monitoring the blood levels, like the platelets, white blood cells, hemoglobin, et cetera. And her oncology team is working on an outpatient plan to monitor these levels at the local clinic so that she can go home. She said they're trying to hammer out a few details that make them nervous that they'll discharge me. And she goes, here's hoping we're on the final stretch.
Good.
Just a prayer request for all the teachers and young people in the school. First few weeks of school, the colds are flying fast and furious, so we got several down with the samples now. Teachers are all basing themselves in hand sanitizer, so just prayers for health and happiness for young people and teachers.
Amen.
Just a request for prayer for my great niece Natalie Manning. She is not quite 3 years old, and she's just been diagnosed with COVID.
Oh gosh.
This is kind of an announcement of joy. The ministry team met and the motorcycle mission arrived. The money has been decided. Money has raised going towards the shipping cost of the boxes for Samaritan first, so all the boxes can go around the world.
That's great.
Jim asked, so that's what.
I was asked
to call. I tend to make mistakes on them, so excuse me if I might be $10 off, but $10,000 is what we have for coach.
Birthday.
We have a cake for after.
I was going to say that too. But a couple other things. I don't remember if it got mentioned during announcements. If you haven't gotten a chance to check out over here, the garage doors have been installed over here. So if you guys want to take a look at those. Also, the other thing was with doing the Facebook page. I don't know if anybody saw on that during the week, but I had somebody contact trying to see if it was the church they grew up with and as a child. What I can tell, it looks like she lives in South Carolina now. Marcia mentioned maybe your parents, maybe Joyce. I don't see Joyce here today. But her name is Janice Duckner Green, and it was in the 1950s. So it was kind of in that time frame. I found an old directory that had a list of pastors. She mentioned the pastors here, and one of them matched. But it was in the same time frame when we were merging with St. Paul's, I think it was, and we had an overlap with like some of the pastors, so I'm not sure. But if you get a chance to check out the post on Facebook, she shared a devotional. It was a pretty neat story about a time when her first individual prayer, I think it was, when she was a child, but it happened to be coming here and ministering the pastor at the time. And so kind of a neat experience doing the Facebook thing.
Anybody else have anything? No? Oh, I did have something else. I'm sorry, this had to do with an announcement. It's that we're revamping the hospitality because we think that the second hospitality group is too much for any individual. So there's a new sign-up sheet there that pulls it down into categories. So check that out after service. Thank you.
I'm going to invite those of you who can and are willing to do something a little more charismatic than what you're used to. No, you don't have to get out your white hankies. But if you are able and you have enough room, if you would treat your chair like the altar and kneel, and we're just simply going to earnestly pray the Lord's Prayer together. But as I kneel, if you're able, join me in kneeling as we pray together the Lord's Prayer. I'll give you a moment. Let us pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Okay, now it's time for our offering. The offering plates are at the back, and we so appreciate all of your giving. And the people online, we appreciate that too. You don't know how much that we have so many things going on in our church. The paint is getting ordered this week. We'll have a whole new outside building painted, and the new ministry missions we're doing for the motorcycles and for the picnics. I just think that Trinity is on a roll, and we are moving and going and growing, and we are thankful for that. We couldn't do it without the offerings that we get every week for you. So let's stand and sing our doxology, please.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below.
Dear Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for this church, this congregation, this group of loving people that love us. We love each other and we love God, and it brings us together. And Lord, we just pray that we can take this message out into the world and share it with others too. Thank you, Lord, for the blessings, the gifts that you've given, and may they be used to just spread the word of the gospel. Amen. Thank you. Okay, I'll take some kids. It's all girls. Trevor, you coming up? Nope. Okay. But now Trevor probably can relate to this. Okay.
Yeah, there you go.
What about this? Do you have any of these at home? Yes, I bet you do. If you play sports, then sometimes we get these great gold medals here. Now, these are from Allen, and most of them are for marathons or half marathons. We have a whole drawer full. You didn't even know I snuck through and grabbed them. But, you know, it's a great honor to get a medal like this. You know, you've accomplished something, you've won. And one of the things you think about with these gold medals is the Olympics. You guys watch the Olympics? Well, I'm going to tell you a story about one of the men in the Olympics. This was several years ago in Barcelona, Spain, and the world saw a great moment in Olympic history. There was a young man, and his name was Derek Redman, and he had dreamed his whole life of winning an award, a gold medal at the Olympics. Worked so hard, you know, just, you know, the amount of time it takes to just even qualify to get there. So he was in his finals, semifinals, and he was ahead. He was doing great, and he rounded that last corner, and he could see the finish line, and he felt a tremendous pain in his right leg, and he went down, just fell to the ground. Oh, he was devastated. So he got himself back up and hopped along and tried to finish the race. And suddenly a large man came out of the stands, pushed aside the security guards, and ran to Derek's side. Anybody have any idea who that would have probably been? His dad. His father said, "Derek, you don't have to finish this. You know, you're hurt." You know, and Derek said, "Yes, I do." And so together, he said, "We're going to finish this." And so he and his dad hobbled the rest of the way to the finish line. Everybody else had gone by him, and the race was basically over. And the stands were just silent as they watched this. And then all of a sudden, everyone stood up and cheered and cheered and cried as they finished the final finish line. Now, he didn't win a gold medal, but he did finish. And he finished with the help of his father. And our Bible lesson today describes a race that we're running that's even bigger and more important than the Olympics. In Hebrews, this is what the Bible says. Since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses, and here we got our big crowd, and so did they at the Olympics, let us run the race that God has set before us. Throw aside anything that will slow us down, and keep your eyes on Jesus. So Jesus is our Father God, and if we have a fight that we are racing towards, the battle is going forward, then we need to keep our eyes on Jesus, and he will help us to win this race. So this is life, and we struggle all the time, but all of our witnesses are urging us on. We have witnesses here locally. We have witnesses in heaven. And Jesus is right there pushing us forward. So we keep our eyes on him so that we can have help to finish our race. So let's say a prayer. Dear Jesus, sometimes life is difficult. Help us to keep our eyes on you and to run the race that is before us In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you, guys. You can go to Sunday school.
I don't know what it is about this time of year. I don't know what it is about
this particular season. But God has brought me to a place in life where I've just been doing a lot of reflecting lately. I've reconnected with some people that, one of which I haven't talked to since 1988, and we're reconnecting again. A lot of today's sermon comes from reflecting over a family vacation that we took to Cadillac, Michigan. 1 year, kind of beachfront moments with God as a family. And I just remember being there as a family, and I'm watching my three kids building sandcastles and hunting for seashells and just laughing and having a great time. And it was in that very moment that I realized I had become disconnected. I had somehow allowed the busyness and the complexities of everyday life to create a distance. I had become disconnected from the very people I love more than anyone on the face of this earth. Have you ever felt that feeling? Have you ever felt accidentally disconnected? Well, to broaden your scope of reflection, let me lovingly remind you, the person you're sitting next to, you're connected to. As fellow believers in the body of Christ, we are connected, but we share something in common. Here's the problem we share in common. It is so incredibly easy to get disconnected. It's so easy for it to happen. It seems like it can happen in the blink of an eye. I just remember sitting there or walking down the beach, waves crashing on the shore, and one question walked with me. What crashes relationships? What crashes relationships, and how do we rebuild relationships after the crash? Or better yet, how do we prevent them from crashing in the first place? Well, hopefully you'll be relieved to know that you do not need a PhD in psychology to get better at relationships. You can thank me for the money you're saving in medical or student debt later. Through the lens of God's Word, we discover that every relational problem that we have stems from one of four negative attitudes. Every problem we've ever had in any relationship can be traced back to four relational or relationship crashers, we'll call them. Relationship crashers. We'll look at number one today. The number one relationship crasher is selfishness. Selfishness sinks relationships. This is the number one enemy, the number one cause of conflict, the number one cause of arguments, the number one cause of divorce. A selfish person is an inward-focused person. Relationships crash because we are selfish. I want what I want, you want what you want, and if what you want gets in the way of what I want, we have angry and conflict and arguments and it's just not good. Now, don't just take my word for it. James chapter 2, the first two verses. Do you know where your fights and arguments come from? They come from the selfish desires that war within you. The selfish desires that war within you. Now, before you have that knee-jerk reaction and you think to yourself, but I'm not selfish, let me just lovingly remind you, selfishness is sneaky. You don't start out that way. You don't start out hiding the Oreos in the Raisin Bran box so you can have them all to yourself, right? Selfishness is sneaky. It slithers into a relationship, and then it does the most evil thing. It slithers into a relationship, and then it hides for a while. See, selfishness hides in the newness of a relationship. When a relationship is new, don't we work really, really hard at not being selfish? Oh, no, 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 dear. After you, I insist. No, 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 we don't have to watch the ball game. We can watch the Hallmark Channel in March. That's fine. We're very unselfish at the start of a relationship, but as time goes on, the oddest thing begins to happen. And selfishness stops hiding, and it starts creeping closer and closer to the surface, and the next thing you know, your Oreos are missing. We also see this in the four stages of a married cold. The first year sounds something like this. Baby, darling, honey bunch, sweetums, I am worried about that sniffle. So I've got the paramedics on their way. They're going to take you to the hospital, and they're going to get you a checkout and a full week's rest. Oh, and honey bear, I know how much you dislike hospital food, so I'm having gourmet meals brought in just for you. That's the first year. The second year of marriage sounds more like this. You know, you look like you've got a fever. Why don't you drive yourself over to MedCheck and get some medicine? I'll watch the kids. Third year. Now look, Karen, only use that if your spouse's name is actually Karen. Apparently, there's a whole other definition that I, you know, got to be careful. Look, Karen, be sensible. After you feed and bathe the kids, wash the dishes, and iron my shirt, you really should get some rest. Fourth year, if it lasts that long. Fourth year. For Pete's sake, hon, and in this moment, in your mind, hon is not short for honey, it's short for Attila. For Pete's sake, hon, do you have to cough so loud? I can't hear the TV. Would you mind going in the other room while the game is on? You sound like a bulldog choking on a pork chop. One guy said, you know, the first year of my marriage was so nice. My wife would bring me my slippers. The dog would come in barking, and now my dog brings me the slippers, and my wife is always barking. Selfishness is sneaky without realizing it. Gradually, over time, we just stop making the effort that we once made. We stop focusing so much out here, and we start focusing almost exclusively in here. In fact, that's actually the definition of a selfish person. Again, the definition of a selfish person is they're an inward-focused person. Now, let me ask you a question that you may have been asked before, but not in this context. Here's my question. Do you have any change? Not pocket change, but life change. Do you have any change? See, even after we notice the selfishness in here, it is so incredibly challenging to change out here. It's very difficult to change from being selfish to being selfless. And one of the biggest reasons for that is how selfishness just comes so incredibly easy. It's just so natural. It's just almost second nature, isn't it? I mean, I don't think about you, you don't think about me, I think about me, you think about you, and that's just what we do. In fact, here's what I know about you. You do not go to bed every night anxious and worried about my bills and my budget. You don't. You love me, you care about me, but you don't lay awake at night contemplating my financial readiness for retirement. You don't walk around all day stressed about my kids' academic standing, or did Jeff remember to lock the back door today? No, see, I think about my wants, my needs, my desires, how I look, how I feel, who hurt me, who failed me, who let me down. It's the classical music approach to life, right? Me, 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 me. And it all comes so naturally. We said before, drift happens. And in this context, we don't naturally drift towards selflessness. We naturally drift towards selfishness. It's just how we're made. Just think about the last time someone handed you a stack of pictures. Well, hang on. For those of you under 40, we used to actually print out paper copies of our pictures and hold them in our hands. I know, it's crazy, right? Okay, so maybe when's the last time someone handed you their phone and said, here, take a look at these pictures? What's the very first thing you do? You immediately start looking for you, right? You don't care about the beautiful bride and her $30,000 wedding dress or the wedding cake that was flown in from an exclusive bakery in France. You don't look about who was where, when, and with who. No, 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 no. You want to see you. Where is my ugly mug in all of these pictures? You took 350 pictures and I'm only in two of them? And my eyes are closed in one of them. And you're doing the pinch and zoom thinking, Photoshop, Photoshop, Photoshop. Selfishness comes so easily, so naturally. It just kind of oozes out of us. Now, here's why I've spent so long on this. This is true of churches too. This is true of churches too. Did you know a church can be selfish? There is such a thing as a selfish church. And believe it or not, the dialogue of the selfish church is nearly identical to that of the selfish individual. I think about my wants, my needs, my desires, my pew, my view, my style of music too. Who hurt me? Who failed me? Who let me down? Again, it's the classical music approach to church. Me, 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 me. Selfishness is sneaky, especially for a church. Without realizing it, over time, we just kind of stop making the outward effort that we once made. We stop focusing out there, and we focus almost exclusively in here. A selfish church is an inward-focused church. A church that exists to serve me and mine and those who are already here and already convinced. It's a church that has lost its focus on the true reason for its actual existence: to reach people far from God. That's why we're here, folks. To reach people far from God. Now, lest we underestimate the danger that we're talking about, I want to share with you words from church health expert Tom Rainer. He goes so far as to declare this. Stated simply, the most common factor in declining churches. Okay, so if you've ever wondered, why are so many churches declining, even right here in our county? Why are so many churches closing their doors and putting a for sale sign up in the front lawn of the church? What's the most common factor? Well, here it is. Simply stated, the most common factor in declining churches is an inward focus. He goes on to say this. The ministries are only for the members. The budgetary funds are used almost exclusively to meet the needs of the members. The times of worship and worship styles are geared primarily for the members. Conflict takes place when the members don't get things their way. Ouch. That is a quite blunt but powerful truth, right? One of the consequences of becoming an inward-focused church is that the church that focuses solely in here eventually becomes invisible to the people out there. The more you think about you and I think about me, the quicker the death of our community. The more I focus on my generation and you focus on your generation, the less impact and influence we have on the next generation. And friends, if we have no impact, no engagement on the next generation, we're not just being selfish, we're being downright cruel. If we're not actively connecting the next generation to the Jesus of the Bible, we're failing. We're failing at being a church. The psalmist puts it this way. We will not hide these truths from our children. We will tell the next generation about the glorious deeds of the Lord, about His power and His mighty wonder. Now, don't get me wrong, I don't for one microsecond think that anyone here would intentionally hide the truths of God's Word from the next generation. After all, the next generation is our kids and our grandkids. We would never hide the truth of God's Word from our children or our grandchildren. But what we're beginning to see is the unintentional disconnect between the church and the next generation. Serious. So serious, in fact, that 27% of non-Christian millennials believe the Bible is a dangerous book of religious dogma used to oppress people. Wow. So while we would never intentionally hide the truth of God's Word from the next generation, the hard-to-hear truth is many churches do. Not because they don't teach the truth, but because of their approach to teaching the truth. In other words, the programs and plans and activities of our church can become so unappealing to the adults in our community that we unknowingly and unintentionally communicate to them, hey, listen, if you want to embrace the Christian faith, that's great. I'm all for it. If you want to know more about the God of the Bible, I'm so excited. Good for you. But honestly, you may have to find another church for that. Because my church is designed and structured primarily to be meaningful for me and people like me. It's not really designed for you and people like you. And none of us want to be responsible for inadvertently communicating anything even remotely close to that. So we have to ask the same question of ourselves as a church that we asked of ourselves as individuals. Do we have any change? Not offering plate change that we're going to give to missions. Life change. Do we have any change? Do we have any strategic organizational change? Proverbs 28:25 warns us, selfishness only causes trouble. All right, so we've heard a lot about the problem. What's the answer? If being selfish crashes relationships, then it seems perfectly logical to suggest that being selfless builds relationships. Selflessness creates change. Selflessness generates change. And while it's not natural, selfless is simple. I think about myself a little less and you a little more. It's a little less of me, a little more of you. Less of me and more of him. I'm intentional about thinking about other people. I'm intentional about Philippians 2:4 that says, look out for one another's interests, not just your own. In fact, one of the reasons being selfless builds relationships so powerfully has to do with how it generates change. You've probably seen it happen. Selflessness draws out the best in others. If you're selfless towards me, it naturally draws out the best me out of me. If you start acting selfless in relationship, it forces the other person to change because you're not the same anymore, and now they have to relate to the new you in a new way. So selflessness not only changes the relationship, it changes the individuals in that relationship. I've seen it over and over, and some of you have too. I've seen the most unlovable, unlikable, cranky, crotchety people that nobody wants to be around, but you start being selfless to them. And over time, not every time, but most times, over time, two things happen. One, it confuses and bewilders them. It does. And second, over time, it changes them. It changes them. Much like the character that Jack Nicholson plays in As Good As It Gets. He is a man with quirks and compulsions and hang-ups and, well, let's just be honest, he's just downright mean. But Helen Hunt's character demonstrates genuine selflessness, and it transforms him. Let's watch this.
Since you brought it up before.
And?
No. I don't get this place. They make me buy a new outfit. They let you in a house dress. I don't get it. What? Wait, well, no, wait, why? Where are you going? Now, why? I mean, I didn't mean it that way. I mean, you gotta sit down. Still give me the dirty look. Just sit down and give it to me.
Pay me a compliment, Melvin. I need one. Quick. You have no idea how much what you just said hurt my feelings.
The moment someone gets that they need you, they threaten to walk out.
A compliment is something nice about somebody else.
This is a request from Judy.
Now or never.
Okay.
Happy anniversary.
Mean it.
Can we order first?
Okay.
Think so? Two hard shell crab dinners, pitcher ice cold beer, baked or fries. One baked, one fried.
I'll tell your waiter.
Okay. Now, I got a real great compliment for you, and it's true.
I'm so afraid you're about to say something awful.
Don't be pessimistic. It's not your style. Okay. Here I go. It's clearly a mistake. I've got this, ailment. My doctor, a shrink that I used to go to all the time, he says that in 50 or 60% of the cases, a pill really helps. I hate pills. Very dangerous thing, pills. Hate. I'm using the word hate here about pills. Hate. My compliment is, that night when you came over and told me that you would never... All right, well, you were there. You know what you said. Well, my compliment to you is, the next morning, I started taking the pills.
I don't quite get how that's a compliment for me.
You make me want to be a better man.
That's maybe the best compliment of my life.
Well, maybe I overshot a little because I was aiming at just enough to keep you from walking out.
Can you imagine sitting across from someone And in the silence, they just look you dead in the eye and say, you know, you make me want to be a better Christian. You make me want to be a stronger Christian. It's perhaps one of the best compliments you could possibly receive. So we've looked at a common problem. We've looked at a solution. Sometimes even after you have the solution, you still need to know the how, right? And I know the solution, so how do I make that happen? Here it is. We're going to look at the next verse. Live freely, animated and motivated by God's Spirit. Then you won't feed the compulsions of selfishness. Live freely, animated and motivated by God's Spirit. He says the only way you can break the cycle of selfishness is by the presence and the power of God Almighty Himself moving and working through you. Because listen, and you know this is true. Anybody can be unselfish for a while. Anybody can be unselfish when their birthday is right around the corner. Anybody can be selfish for a while, but God is saying, I want unselfishness to be a part of your lifestyle. And there's only one way for that to happen. God's Spirit moving and working in you, leading you on to a life of selflessness. In fact, let's let that be our prayer this morning. Father in heaven, we recognize fully that there have been times in our past when the choices that we made, the decisions, the paths that we took were selfish. We just humbly ask that you would forgive us for that. We pray that your Holy Spirit would come alive in us. Bring to light any selfish thoughts, actions, or motives that may exist within us. Give us change, Father, we pray, that we might honor you. Thank you, in Jesus' name.
Stand for our closing song.
When all I see is the battle, you see my victory.
Kim, can we have that a little louder?
When all I see is a mountain, you see a mountain moved. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you. Fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And if you are for me, who can be against me? Yeah. For Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. When all I see are the ashes, you see the beauty. So when I fight, I'll fight on
Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadow. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Come, almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadow. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. In almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. My hand lifted high, oh God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night, oh God, the battle belongs to you. Oh God, the battle belongs to you.
I hope all of you have enjoyed our current sermon series as much as I have. I am just so excited. We've got a couple weeks left, and in my humble opinion, the next 2 weeks you should be excited about too. It's going to be good stuff, so invite a friend to come along, and we'll join together again next week. Don't forget, hospitality, you can smell it. It makes your stomach growl. God, we just want to say thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you for your many blessings. We could never thank you enough. The best we can do is just devote our lives to you as a way of saying thank you for your many blessings. Thank you, God. We love you. We praise you. We dedicate ourselves to your service in Jesus' name. And all God's children said, amen. 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 God bless you all.